I start, give me a sense of how many of you know what unikernels are. Oh, this is brilliant. This is brilliant. So this is pretty much a typical inversion of giving the talk where I have to justify this entire effort. So I'm going to quickly leap through the reasons why we're building unikernels, and I wanted to tell you about some of the unique thing that makes this Mirage project different among the growing number of them available. And the first thing that leapt out at me is that a few years ago, Marius Ericsson from Twitter observed that it's really hard to build composable services. And we've heard this a lot during the talks today. And the enemy really is complexity. So we've built up these layers and layers of software stacks, and applications have become intertwined as the years have gone by, and essentially they lack portability. So you could use POSIX in the past, something else you use Windows, but even these days, POSIX is not a viable alternative for building high-performance applications. We've seen, again in the other talks, a number of the hacks and the extensions you have to build to specialize something for Linux, for a particular user space network stack or whatever to make things work. And the thing we're trying to get rid of is this unbounded scope for uncontrolled interaction between components. There's choices all the way up into the network stack, from the hypervisor to the operating system to the application and all of the frameworks and so on in between that you use. Now, the thing I was surprised and not many talks here have mentioned is this new spring we're seeing of embedded devices. And a lot of them have been coming out of shortage, in fact. So Berg, who sadly are no longer trading, but they built this really nice little printer. We've seen Nest build thermostats, got tweeting weight scales and so on. For some reason, you've got a growing number of very personalized services that still run a full general-purpose, often Linux-based or BSD-based stack, and are embedded all over the world. So this is, if you listen to ARM, the next wave of trillion devices that are going to be net-connected. And the thing that scares me, really does scare me at a fundamental level, is just how shocking system security is when you build all these things. And so one of the reasons we started this Mirage project was because just very, very tired of having to deal with a just continuous series of attacks coming in at all layers of the software stack. So we asked ourselves this very simple question, which if you want to avoid depending on all of this software that has been built up over 20 years that seems to not have been particularly well audited, is often just written in C. There's some very good C code, and there's some very bad C code. I'll let you judge from this slide which is which. But OpenSSL particularly stands out as a very worrying bit of infrastructure that we all depend on for a huge amount of the world's commerce. So what we've been working on is saying that if we get rid of backwards compatibility as one of our golden standards that we depend on, and just go back to the early days of the internet where the IETF would give us protocols, you could build those protocols using any framework you want, and it's only the network connection you're talking to that really matters. We don't have ABIs that were, you know, specify Linux ABI or Windows ABI. We just want to talk TCP, we want to talk HTTP, we want to talk TLS. And anything past that barrier is game for a rewrite. And if you did do this, what would the world look like? And so remember, this started as a research project, but it very rapidly turned into something that is a self-hosting usable system, and it turned into this concept of unikernel. So all of these slides, everything I'm showing you here, has actually been written using Mirage. And the entire stack that this is being served off is about a 1 megabyte unikernel running under Xen. So one thing you might not realize is that Xen has now been ported to the ARM platform. Is Ian Jackson in the room?
Yes.
Oh, there he is. Yep. It's his fault. And along with Ian Campbell as well. So the Xen development team has done a great job. So they've taken the hypervisor, which runs on x86 usually, and Itanium, for anyone that cares, and a few other experimental platforms. But it's now being hosted off this board, which I will very gingerly hold up so I don't disconnect its power. It's actually running a unikernel that is completely type-safe, all the way from the low-level device drivers all the way up to the actual network stack that it runs, and the HTTP logic and so on. And interestingly enough, this unikernel is so small that you can actually track the outputs in Git as well. So it's not like... during the Weave talk, Alex has mentioned that you have to download hundreds of megabytes of binaries to update to the new Docker. Well, in this world, you just need to upload artifacts which are often smaller than the Linux source tree, for example, because they're very specialized. This is just a picture, in case you couldn't see this. It's very small. And it's a QB board, costs about 39 quid. So I just wanted to highlight some of the differences between Docker and unikernels, but also why they're very complementary. So when you take something like Docker, you take an entire host network stack. And what Docker does an extraordinarily good job of is hiding all of that and encapsulating and bundling it into a runtime that it presents a very simple to use programming interface. But the fact that you've shoved everything into this big shipping container doesn't get rid of it. So this means whenever you deploy your ARM devices or your cloud services, you're still running a very, very fat network stack. You've got the hypervisor at the bottom level to give you the really strong isolation. You've then got a sequence of Linux kernel support, and then on top of that, you've got user space, and all of these layers add up. So what we're aiming to do is, with Mirage, can we modularize our operating system? So can we build code? And remember, the operating system's code tends to survive for decades. I still have code I've committed into OpenBSD, which is still around for better or worse. And what we want to do with this is to step back for a second and say, if we break up what we normally think of as an operating system into modular chunks, can this source code that we're building on Camel be deployed in an incredible variety of situations? And I'll show you examples of what that means. And also, at the same time, we want to do deployments that don't include the entire kitchen sink, and that they strip away, as you go to deployment, exactly the right amount of functionality you need. And also, we want to target really, really weird platforms. So I mentioned that we support ARM, we support Xen targets, but Mirage is not actually a Xen operating system. And I'll show you a JavaScript backend that we have, which isn't, you know, it's got some interesting uses from the same code base. So the unikernels are basically specialized virtual machine images that include the full stack. There's application code, system libraries, and also configuration. So this, the fact that you have configuration lets you do a lot of the specialization by stripping away stuff that you just don't use. And just to give you a sense of some of the benefits of specifically of Mirage, we're aiming to make something contained, compact, and efficient. So by contained, it means that everything you need in the deployment you're doing is in that final output binary, because it only depends on a very lightweight hypervisor. It's compact, which reduces the amount of attack surface we have to secure, and it's highly efficient, because it just does less than a normal operating system. And so one of the crucial things when you build these unikernels is figuring out how you can make this stuff usable. It's all very well and good for me to say, we've rewritten the universe in OCaml, but it's another thing to actually come up with a workflow where if you're deploying a web service or you're deploying some high-level service, that you don't have to become a kernel hacker to use this this high-level bit of code. And so this is the way it works. Our goal in Mirage is to develop in a full stack and ultimately to compile away something that forms a unikernel that runs directly in Xen. But what I really want to do is to develop all of my logic under Unix or Windows or even a JavaScript IDE and use the full general purpose operating system as a host for building all of the complicated logic and debugging that I need to do. Once I've developed that logic, I want to test the unikernel by progressively getting rid of my addiction to the general purpose operating system. And this means that I can, for example, start removing the network stack and putting in a pure OCaml network stack, and I can still test that the semantics still works. So for example, one very common way of doing this is by using user space networking to remove kernel sockets from the equation and to start using user space networking to start parsing packets in OCaml. But all of the logic you developed earlier should still be maintained. You're just slowly getting rid of the stack. And finally, whenever you're happy that all of your logic works, for example, I was just recompiling the slide deck about 5 minutes ago, then and I recompiled it, and then the final version would be running this unikernel that you then deploy into Xen, and I put x86 down there, but showing here ARM is just fine as well. So is this workflow, which is the key to unlocking unikernels. It's you can just develop like you would develop a normal app, and instead of doing a deployment to some kind of a cloud service, you just do one extra step, which is to compile the specialized version, and then everything else can just use a normal Docker, Weaver, whatever web services or cloud stack you're using for your day-to-day deployments. And the reason the benefits show up is because the final thing that we specialize is extremely minimal. It's got a single address space. This is the x86 memory layout, but the ARM memory layout is similar, designed by Thomas Leonard. And the idea is that you simply say that the only thing that this kernel can do is to run one OCaml runtime. And we have specialized spaces in the virtual memory layout for OCaml. And also, we separate out all foreign I/O. So this system is single CPU. If you wanted to do multi-core, you spin up multiple virtual machines. And all of the network packets and storage that come in are tracked in a special part of virtual memory. So this means that we can then start writing OCaml code that treats foreign data coming in as normal OCaml values, but held in a different part of the world. And then we can start designing zero-copy network stacks and all of the things we need to do to make this handle real traffic. But crucially, we always maintain a single address space. The threat model inside the Xen Uni kernel is that we trust all the code running in there, and we depend on type safety to provide protection. And then it's as hardened as it possibly can be against external threats, so external buffer overflows, or any kind of logical attacks that might come along. So the end result, just to quickly finish this summary that I've been going through, is that these unikernels have a lot of benefits. Firstly, they just boot and they respond to network traffic in real time. And if you look at the size of these binaries, these are some realistic examples from some of the self-hosting infrastructure we've built. And you can see that just with a standard OCaml build, they're about 0.5 MB in size. And by doing a little bit more exotic dead code elimination, by getting rid of intra-module analysis, we can get it down to hundreds of kilobytes. And this DNS server is fully type safe. So this includes all the device drivers and everything it needs to serve as a top-level domain server, for example. The DNS work was actually sponsored by VeriSign a few years ago. So it's very compelling in terms of the attack surface being reduced without any significant loss of functionality. It still serves DNS. That's the only thing the DNS server has to do. But the interesting thing is that you can also then boot these things so fast that you can boot them in 20 milliseconds in x86. So once you've built one of these specialized things, you can almost start treating it like a process. So in this example, we're showing boot time, and this is Linux stripped down to the absolute minimum kernel we could come up with. So this is before CoreOS, but it's sent a single UDP packet from user space with a custom written init grid. The first thing we observe is that unikernels can go all the way down to even 8 MB that they boot in, and they're just booting almost instantaneously. The difference between the unikernels and Linux here is that the unikernel can boot comfortably within a TCP SYN-ACK response time. So if you have a cluster of services, you can now start deciding between hosting that in a specialized virtual machine with all of the isolation that Xen provides versus just routing it to a normal Nginx stack running in Unix, for example. So for the first time, we can actually start deciding between how much safety and security we want for a particular given connection. So how does this work? So I wanted to show you. So here I have the network stack running. Now, I've just realized that with this mic, it's going to be hard to type. So let me see if I can put this mic down, if you can still hear me. Oh. He's a NetBSD guy. That's pretty much all they're good for. So. I'm an OpenBSD developer. So the Mirage OS workflow is that I want to write my OCaml application using some Mirage concepts, and all I have to do is type in Mirage configure this particular application under Unix. I can then say I want to recompile that same application under Unix, you know, so I can debug it. I then want to say from the same source code, I will Mirage configure that app with -- Xen, and without any changes, this thing will recompile. So how does that work? So the essence of Mirage, the thing that makes it different for all the unikernels, is this modular architecture. So it consists of two things. And this is a bit like one of these child's games where you have to create some shapes, and you have to fit the square peg in the square hole and not the round hole. So what we do is we define a collection of module types. And what these module types do is that they describe the structural shape of a particular part of an operating system. And I'll explain what these mean. So for example, in fact, why don't I save Justin's hand? I will do all the typing in one go. So I can show you all the demos at the end. Thank you very much for that. And once we define these shapes, we then define a bunch of libraries that fill in the shapes, given the particular context that we're compiling to. And I'll give you an example of what this means. But first, let me show you what these shapes mean. And this is the only actual ML here. I figured you guys might like to see a little bit of OCaml to see what this module system I keep talking about is. So whenever we design a particular shape, we define what's called a module type. Now, can everyone see this? I'll just make it a little bit bigger so you can see what's going on. This module type defines a few very abstract concepts. It says, I want to build a device driver. And a device driver in my world is that it has some type of I/O, that is, it can do blocking operations. It has some abstract state that it represents as a device, and it has an identifier. So this is some attach string that we'll use to attach to, so you can identify the device. Then we define a series of functions. So one function that says, given your state, can you give me back your identifier? Given an identifier, can you connect and either give me back an error or a state, and then disconnect. So it's very straightforward. then you can go on and build even more sophisticated things. For example, I can describe network flows. And we have, as we heard from one of the earlier talks, we have a variety of things that can represent network flows. It can be TCP, it can be shared memory, there's any number of things. So we then define this very abstract flow that again has a notion of I/O, but now it has this abstract notion of a buffer. It doesn't care what this buffer is. It can be a shared memory buffer, it can be a TCP NIC buffer. And then we just define a series of operations here. So a read will give me back either an end of file, an error, or the buffer, a write and a write V and so on will do all the same things. Now where these shapes get amazing is that we can compose them. So I can take these two shapes I've just defined. I've just defined the notion of a device in a flow, and I can now build a TCP/IP device driver. And so this shape says that we now again define some abstract concepts like a buffer, some notion of IPv4, but I will include the device driver here, and I will fuse some of the types together, and I'll also then include flow, and I will fuse those types together as well. And so what Mirage does is that it builds about 100 of these shapes. These shapes represent all parts of an operating system, and so it turns out we can build up some very, very complicated abstractions just by defining these simple concepts like, this is what I expect every library to do, to define a device driver. I want every library that involves flows to define a flow interface. And you can just put them together, and anything that satisfies that is now part of your module system. It turns out that while it looks quite trivial for things like flows and devices, it becomes much more interesting when you're dealing with system-critical components. So we spent about the last year building a TLS stack as part of the project by Hannes Menhard and David Kaliper. And the question of entropy comes up. Entropy is a thorny issue in virtual environments because it turns out you don't have any, right? So when you're trying to build an SSL stack, that's a problem. So we designed a module type to try to describe very precisely what we mean by entropy. And it turns out that you can actually quite succinctly, I won't go into the details, describe the shape of entropy such that it can map to everything from JavaScript to weird Linux, u-random behavior, and hardware device drivers, just by using this notion of higher order functions. So I've told you at a very high level how these shapes work, and if anyone's interested in more details afterwards, I can point you at the full list of shapes. It's in the Mirage source repository. But then after this, we need to describe for the whole application actual implementations of what's going on. And so what we've done is that we've defined these shapes, and we've built about, I think it's about 80 libraries now, that are full implementations of normal network protocols that fit these shapes under various circumstances. So, and this is a very elaborate set. It's probably, it's well into the 100,000 lines of CAML, and it includes some very complicated protocols like TLS, which is a suite of libraries. And one thing we noticed is that we didn't build a big network stack. What we built was a sequence of small libraries that satisfy little individual components. And it's a very simple approach. So I just bought some Sonos speakers the other day, and I just wanted to play some music. And it turns out that to use this thing, you need to have some weird HTTP protocol that's layered over UPnP, over UDP. There's no RFC that describes this bizarre combination of things. But by just applying the right Mirage modules, I actually managed to get music playing in my house. Instead of having to write a bespoke HTTP server that ran over UPnP, I could just do just the right implementations. So it's really nice that we can actually start taking some of these libraries and applying them to weird and wonderful use cases. And crucially, these modules that we built satisfy a vast number of backends. So they work under Unix, they can map concepts of Unix to Xen, but also to JavaScript and Linux kernel modules and so on. So the shapes define the structure of the application, the modules define actual implementations. So a lot of the concepts here, you'll be wondering, why do we really need ML? And the reason is that when you build one of these components, it's a lot like a C++ template, where when you build C++ templates, you basically describe an environment over which this template should be applied. Now, what ML does is that it takes this concept and adds a huge amount of type safety on top of it. So if you ever study ML and you run something called functors, it's essentially a module that can depend on another module. So I can say that I would like to build an HTTP service that depends on existence of some notion of a network channel, but I don't have to define what that network channel is. And so that's what this idea of functors are. And so the reason we picked ML is because it has one of the most powerful module systems on any language on the planet, without making it overly complicated. It's not an object-oriented system, it's not a class-based hierarchy, it's simply these modules that are shapes, and you just have to fit the implementations into the shapes. So let me give you an example of what this looks like. So whenever you build this website that's showing you right now, All I have to do is I can define some XAML code that says when you start, here's an HTTP callback. I will parse the URI and I will do some HTTP operations. The only difference is, at the very top, we said that this is not a normal application, but it's abstracted across the environment in which it runs. I will have to give it a console, I will have to give it a key value store, and we'll have to give it an HTTP server. So we can just define this tiny little component that, given the existence of these modules, can be compiled into something concrete. And that's the only difference, is that we're building these slightly more abstract websites that don't depend on an operating system. So how does this work in practice? Well, in practice, this is exactly how our workflow can be satisfied. Because let's say that I'm developing on Unix. I can present this on the Mac. And then I have my home page, which depends on HTTP. Then I have an HTTP library, which depends on TCP. It's called CoHTTP. And then because we're developing on Unix, TCP is provided by the Unix kernel, right? It makes sense. But just by swapping out the implementation, I can say, well, I would like to switch the same high-level logic here, which can be an entire website, to user space networking. And at this point, the notion of TCP just comes from something that depends on Ethernet that then uses TunTap, and then it provides a different route to do user space networking. This is pretty good. So we can replace TunTap without modifying any of the other code with, for example, one of the user space networking stacks like MTCP or something else, but still use all of the high-level logic we've built. But then we really just want to get rid of Unix, right? So our last niggling dependency is this TunTap driver that gives us Ethernet frames. Well, we can get rid of that too, because we can say that instead of providing a Unix network interface, just start linking to all the Xen libraries that provide this functionality. So at this point, my network interface comes from a shared memory ring, which is a Xen interface, which is then provided through a complicated series of Xen modules that eventually provide you with network frames, which is what you wanted. So without you seeing what's happening behind the scenes, the fact that we built this modular application lets the Mirage system decide the route through the module stack to satisfy your particular deployment need. And that's the key idea behind modularity, that lets us reuse the high-level code that we've been spending years building, yet still provide increasingly specialized backends. So let me show you an example of this. But just to recap, I'm throwing a lot of information at you here. The idea is that we build our applications as code parameterized by the environment in which it runs, and with no dependencies on an OS. You depend on the specific parts of the OS that you really need, like a network stack or a block stack. And then this idea of ML modules separate the dependencies and break down the monolithic into something more manageable. So this actually means that when you write the configuration for this Mirage website, we just write another little XAML fragment, and your entire server just becomes something you evaluate as a configuration file at compile time, and it generates a sequence of modules that you need to navigate that tree that I just showed you. In this case, I'm just saying that this is a website, it's an HTTP server running on port 80, and I want to give it a certain set of device drivers. So whenever I do a make build in Mirage, all it does is it figures out the set of device drivers that I need, and it makes sure they match up to the abstractions that I used in my application. So in this case, recall that my original website depended on a console, a key value store, and a web server. In this case, it will get the console key value store from the configuration file. The details don't matter, but essentially, there's a typed equivalence between the two. So when you generate this code, the really cool thing is that you can decipher what's going on just by looking at the generated code. So in this case, we have Unix, and Unix, you can see that I can create a TCP/IP socket stack, that's a kernel stack from a console. I can then take that console and turn it into a conduit. I can then take the conduit and create an HTTP server. And again, I can then take the HTTP server and construct my entire application. And this is a fully realized Unix socket version of this website. But then when I recompile it, it starts getting more interesting. Because this stack that previously was just provided by the Linux kernel turns into, oh, hang on, if you give me a network interface, I will give you Ethernet. And then given the Ethernet, I will give you IP. Given IP, I will give you UDP. And then I can construct TCP from those previous modules, but I need some more things, because TCP is more complicated than UDP. So given some time and some entropy, I will give you a TCP stack. But at the end of this, the stack is just a self-contained module that is then passed all the way through the other modules we've defined. So this way, we can choose where in the stack we cut off our levels of abstraction. So you never need to know the existence of Xen when you're writing this high-level unikernel code. You just have to worry about the module that you're working on, and the system will provide all the rest for you. So we're just abstracting away kernel complexities from the user. So the result of this, I mean, this is an enormous amount of trouble to go to, unless there's a point to all of it. And the point is that we can take a bit of web logic or a bit of DNS logic that we've carefully audited, we might have done a little bit of formal verification, and we can recompile it into this incredible sequence of deployments. So we can say that the Xen unikernel can be built with all data built in, it can be dynamically read from disk, you can have a binary data passing through, or you can even compile it to JavaScript. So I wanted to show you quickly an example. Oh, I wanted to show this at the end again, so I don't have to do the juggling. But you can actually compile a lot of the stack directly into an interactive browser in JavaScript. So the reason that this this suddenly becomes relevant to a lot of the DevOps workflows that we talk about is that the entire thing can be tracked in GitHub. So the workflow for updating this is that we can take some source code updates, and I can put them into GitHub and Mirage WW. It then uses the Travis system to rebuild them, and the end result ends up in somewhere called Mirage deployment. So now if I do the juggling, let me see if I can get this. So here we have a ByteMark hosted server, and I did a recent update of the website, so I can simply do git pull and deploy.sh. And what this will do is it will simply take the results of Travis, which is a 1 megabyte unikernel, so it doesn't take very long to update, although this is going over local Wi-Fi, and it simply does the update and it constructs the new updated site. So the only thing we need to do to track one of these deployments is use GitHub just to track the outputs as well. And you can see here, when I go to the deployment, you can have a SHA-hash of all of the provenance of where this came from. And if I look at MirrorWW, it's a 2.9 megabyte unikernel. It's bigger than 1 megabyte because it includes internally all of the images and everything that make up that website. So it is completely standalone. And this just totally changed the way we work. So we just use Git as part of the normal workflow to manage everything to do with the lifecycle of unikernels. We can use Git tag to link code and binaries. We can use Git log to check out change logs. Amazingly, we can use Git bisect to go back through our entire operating system code base to decide when a deployment failure happened, just running a normal shell script. And this is because these things are so small and so agile that you can just do that, all the while maintaining full type safety. And similarly, now everything is written in OCaml, so everything is immune to the low-level overflows, but you obviously have logical bugs. So instead of waiting for all of our dependencies to have binaries propagated, because we're recompiling to build our final service, we just watch Git directly, wait for a security update in a branch, and just recompile the whole lot. So it gives you this ability to collapse a chain of security updates to deploy these changes in seconds if necessary. So in theory, we could close the security hole in less than a second after it's been announced by a push to a public repository. As you can imagine, that would be useful to avoid 0 days. And it also gives you the ability to write the application more than once and deploy to multiple sites. So the reason that this was called Jitsu is we've been wondering what a unikernel hosting service should look like, and this is what we want to chat to you guys about. So given this combination of Git workflow and fast boot, so Magnus has been building a unikernel that will boot from Git, it can respond to a request, and it can spin up in 20 milliseconds and spin down based on a DNS TTL. And so there is a challenge there. You don't want every single request to be routed to a new unikernel. That's very heavyweight. But the fact is we can now balance off our trade-offs. So you can choose, for example, if you have one of these in your home managing personal data, you can decide exactly how paranoid you want to be about handling a particular connection. For example, this could be from a third-party service you don't quite trust. And DNS can be used to change your routing procedure between Xen or Unix. So it's really quite flexible. So this has been a bit of a whirlwind tour. I wanted to give you a flavor of why modularity is important to us, because we're building up this enormous body of OCaml code, but we're making it really quite amenable to using in very many different contexts. And so if you go to the website on Mirage, there's been a bunch of blogging about Ermine, a from-scratch TLS stack, lots of ways to link to C bindings and so on, and also profiling and other tools as well. And I just wanted to point out, this is a golden opportunity to get involved at the moment with any of these unikernels, because nothing teaches you a protocol like just building it. We didn't really understand how scary TLS was until we just built it from scratch. It's just incredible how much stuff has been hidden under the carpet with that particular protocol. And there's a lot of choices. You pick your favorite language, you choose your trade-offs, you don't have to choose Mirage. RUM kernels or an OSV are great for compatibility, for example. But just pick a scenario, and performance benchmarking these things provides a fantastic way to win the language wars, because you don't have to argue in Hacker News, you just run benchmarks on OCaml versus Haskell in our case. It's an ancient war. like BSD versus Linux. And but one that we're winning at the moment because we're just faster. But we'll probably end up losing shortly. We don't have laziness; we're a strict language. This has been a really fun ongoing battle between Adam Wick at Galois, who developed HalVM, and us as well. But most importantly, we need people to get involved and actually start building protocol implementations. So it feels like a genuine societal responsibility as part of open source to start moving us away from a bunch of the dependencies on old legacy libraries and provide alternatives. So the alternatives might not be adopted, but unless we start doing this with a whole bunch of new programming languages, there's no chance we'll escape from the security wars. There's containment, but ultimately we want to solve the problem and actually build new interesting systems. And so we're doing this under something called NIMOT, which is an entire personal data infrastructure for helping build high-level libraries on top of Mirage so that you can deploy it much more easily. That's why we did the ARM port in the first place, and we're porting it to Raspberry Pi and a number of other backends, because we want the system itself to just become so invisible that you can deploy services like IMAP and SSL and so on in your home without having to become a Linux sysadmin. You just take very specialized kernels that you deploy to the backend, and that's all you need to do to pull that off. And so there's tons of stuff on Open Mirage. It's a Linux incubator project, and there's a lot of people just floating around here as well. So hoping to give you a flavor. Now, if I have 30 seconds, I might be a bit over time. I can show you a really cool JavaScript demo. I don't see Justin pulling me off stage, so I'm just going to do it.
Here we are. Right, I'm just going to balance that. So I mentioned that we can do, this is done by Andy Ray. So we've taken a whole bunch of ideas and we've ported them to this system called IPython, which gives you an interactive JavaScript implementation where you can type in OCaml code into the browser and it will evaluate it because the entire compiler has been compiled to JavaScript. OCaml has a really good JavaScript backend. Now, obviously, I'm not going to go into the details of this, but our goal is to build a video decoder for Mirage. And so what he's done is that he's built all the logic in the browser, and it's really good fun because you can just go through and you can build run the decoder, you can document it in a very literate style. But then what happened was that he took the Mirage HTTP stack. Remember I said you can cut it off at different levels? But he cut it off at an extraordinary high level. He mapped the entirety of core HTTP to XML HTTP requests in JavaScript. And then he took my GitHub bindings and he compiled those in JavaScript. And then he had this ability to just spawn a gist. And then so he's taking this OCaml code and suddenly said, well, I could prototype my entire application in JavaScript, compile it, and do real-time video decoding. It's just pretty fast. The fact that you can now have an interactive IDE, for example, let me corrupt his hard work. I don't know if this hope this works, so let me get rid of my syntax error. And this is corrupted because I've changed the resolution. I can bring that back. This just shows you what I meant by extremely exotic environments. I could take this TCP stack and compile it with JavaScript because there's no C dependencies and so on. Or I could take the DNS stack, or I could take the TLS stack. And I heard a rumor. I don't know how justified this rumor is, but Google uses Enscripten to compile OpenSSL to JavaScript for deployment services. And that is kind of scary. It would be nicer to take a stack designed for JavaScript compilation than to compile an entire operating system in JavaScript. And so if I just solved that one problem, I'd be quite happy if TLS could be deployed. And similarly, when you look at the actual stack here, so just to prove that the whole thing works, here we have a TLS unikernel somewhere here. It is right here. And so this TLS unikernel here is completely built under Xen. So I can create this unikernel. And this is now booting on the ARM board. It's got 192.168.2.35 as its IP address. And if I type in 192.35 from my Mac, I can now connect. It's fully handling in TypeSafe, and it's an Echo server. And you can see there's a whole ton of debug output there. So this is an end-to-end operating system serving up a full TLS connection, which we were working about 15 minutes ago, because it didn't quite work an hour before. That is working. So I hope I've given you a sense for, there can be an alternative to operating systems, and it can be really great languages, and I apologize for running over time. Thank you very much.